All right, I guess we can start the session. So thank you for coming to the Cilium Maintainer Track session. This is Scaling Up and Scaling Out Networking, Observability and Security with Cilium. I'm Bill Mulligan and I work at Isovalent.
My name is Jeff Chen from Chip.com Group.
And I'll be doing the first half of the presentation in English, kind of giving an introduction and overview of Cilium. And then Jeff will be doing his half in Chinese, talking about how Trip.com uses Cilium at scale. So with that, let's get started. So just a show of hand, who even here uses Cilium right now? Okay, cool. You're part of the great community. We have over 100 different companies that have publicly stated that they're using Cilium right now. And we have 45 public case studies. If you haven't added yourself to the list on GitHub yet, please do it so we can help keep track of who's using Cilium. Cilium was a project originally created by Isovalent and then later donated to the CNCF. And it's an eBPF-powered solution for networking, security, and observability. It's the CNI for almost every cloud provider in the cloud-native ecosystem right now, and almost all the Kubernetes distributions. So if you're running Kubernetes right now, you can use Cilium as your CNI. In fact, all the major cloud providers have now picked Cilium for networking and observability in their Kubernetes platform. And if you aren't familiar with eBPF, that's okay. It's a Linux kernel technology, so very low level. And what it does and that sets it apart and really what makes Cilium powerful is that it makes the Linux kernel programmable in a safe and efficient way. And so one example that people kind of like to use is it's kind of like what JavaScript is to the browser. So before JavaScript, we had kind of flat static web pages, but then with JavaScript, suddenly web pages were interactive, and that's exactly what eBPF does to the kernel. It allows us to flexibly and dynamically add new abilities and functionalities to the Linux kernel, which allows us to do a lot of new and interesting things. And it's really important because the Linux kernel is about a 30-year-old technology. So updating it for the cloud native world is difficult, and eBPF helps enable that. So if you aren't familiar with Cilium, so eBPF is the underlying technology, but there's a lot of different parts of the ecosystem. There's the Cilium CNI, which provides high performance and scalable networking. There's Cilium Service Mesh, which is sidecar list free and providing ingress too. There's Hubble for network observability, and Tetragon for security observability and runtime enforcement. So this is kind of the overview, and I'm actually going to go back to the beginning of the project and walk through how each of these pieces came to be. So originally Cilium began as just container networking. So providing a flat layer three and layer four network based on eBPF for even before Kubernetes, just container clusters and then for Kubernetes. As we started to kind of like grow and get more users that were doing kind of more enterprise features, we started to add additional features. And the first one was around network security. So people wanted to be able to secure their clusters. So things like network policy on both layer three and four and layer seven, and encryption. After that, we kind of realized if you have kind of a distributed computing environment, you also need to observe what's going on in the environment. Where are things going wrong? Where are the packets flowing? Where are they not flowing? And that's where Hubble came in. So Hubble is the observability component of Cilium. It provides things like network flow logs, metrics, a service map to the Hubble UI, and allows easy troubleshooting by platform teams and application developers. After that, we realized people aren't just running run Kubernetes clusters, as you'll hear from Trip.com. They're actually running multiple Kubernetes clusters. So we came up with Cluster Mesh, which allows us to network multiple Kubernetes clusters together. As you're running more and more clusters, you also need to start to lock them down because you're running more sensitive and more important workloads. And that's when we added Tetragon, which is the security observability and runtime enforcement part of Cilium. And that can monitor things like syscalls, file access, and network observability. And the last part, then also you need to get the traffic into your clusters too, which is where the Cilium load balancer came in. And this is a very high performance load balancer based on eBPF. And there's also Cilium Service Mesh, which is providing the layer 7 functionality around networking, observability, and security. Once again, kind of the theme around Cilium, providing networking, observability, and security in a cloud-native way. So Cilium Service Mesh is different than a lot of other service meshes you'll see out there because it is in large part powered by eBPF. And that's what makes Cilium itself and also the service mesh really scalable and performant. So whenever possible, we're doing all the traffic routing with eBPF, and there's no proxy in there. And when we can't do that, we fall back to a layer 7 proxy, which is one proxy per node, rather than having a sidecar-based service mesh. Now, kind of like looking forward towards the future, that's kind of the history, and where we're going next. So 1.14 just recently got released. And the big highlights out of that release were mutual authentication for network policy, so enabling what a lot of people use for MTLS when combined with mutual authentication and encryption. As a part of that, a SPIFFI integration to do the authentication. Day 2 operational enhancements to make it easier to run, especially when you're running at significant scale, like we'll hear about. Grafana dashboards in the Hubble UI. Integrations into Istio Ambient Mesh and Cilium Mesh. Now, to kind of talk about these as the really big highlights, so mutual authentication is adding authentication as just a network policy. So it's not something else you need to add. It's really just like a two-line change to add mutual authentication into your network and providing that enhanced identity. This SPIFFI integration is providing that identity for the authentication part, and the day 2 operations is a lot of that kind of like troubleshooting and dashboards through the Grafana integration. And the last component that recently came out was Cilium Cluster Mesh. So up until now, we've really been talking about Kubernetes-based environments, but really your IT infrastructure extends so far beyond just Kubernetes. And so what Cilium Mesh allows you to do through transit gateways is to add other elements of your network infrastructure, like bare metal machines or VMs or other things that you're running on your network, and giving them a Cilium identity and allowing you to treat them as network devices like the rest of your infrastructure being networked by Cilium. If you want to like learn more and get started, the Linux Foundation just recently launched an introduction to training Cilium. Introduction to Cilium training. I know this is an extremely fast overview because I want to give a ton of time to Jeff to talk about what they're doing at trip.com. So this is a great resource to get started. And there's also a Cilium lab page on the Cilium website, and this has more labs to get started. And with that, I'll hand it over.
Okay. 各位下午好，我是来自携程云网络团队的陈航。然后在接下去的十几分钟，会和大家分享一下Cilium在携程生产环境的一个实践，以及我们遇到过的一些挑战和解决方案。那携程 C-Trip 相信大家应该都已经很熟悉了。海外用户的话，也可以从trip.com 去订机票、酒店等等产品。那我们云团队的话，主要是 负责公司的基础设施的开发运维，服务于公司的10000名工程师。简单介绍一下 Cilium 在携程的一个历史。我们是从18年开始去调研 Cilium， 当时的出发点是因为我们当时的那个网络方案和 CNI 无法支持 K8s 集群的一个快速增长。经过一段时间的调研之后，我们是将 Cilium 投入生产。在之后的几年里，将我们的在线应用啊，还有像 Redis、 ES 这样的中间件都陆续的迁到了 Cilium 网络上，然后在今年的话，我们主要是将大量的业务负载跑在了阿里云上，后面会继续介绍。 OK， 我们目前的规模的话是一共有大概 20,000台 Node， 这其中包括IDC 里的物理服务器，还有公有云上的一些虚拟机。 OK， 那这些 Node 上一共跑了35万个 Pod， 然后我们的 Cilium 网络策略的规模是大概有3000左右。 每一秒的话是有20万条的 Hubble Events。 可以简单看一下我们的部署架构。首先，我们的网络的模式是直接路由，然后在 Cilium 云的话是通过 BGP 将 Pod CIDR 通告出去，然后在公有云的话是Pod 直接从 VPC 的 Subnet 分 IP， 所以也是可以直接通的。那每台 Node 的话，每台 Node 上会通过 Hubble 将网络访问的事件。 通过 Kafka 送到我们内部运维的 ELK 系统，最后在 Kibana 做一个展示。然后我们的网络策略的话是通过 Kubefed 去做一个统一的创建下发，来确保每一个集群有一致的一个网络策略。然后多集群的方案的话，我们是使用一个叫做 KVStore Mesh 的设计去替代了 Cilium 社区的 Cluster Mesh， 后面会详细介绍一下。 那简单总结一下 Cilium 给我们带来的一些好处，首先的话是集群的一个可扩展性，我们最大的集群是一度跑到过6000家的 Node， 然后在数据面也是很稳定，在生产跑了大概超过4年的时间，同时 Cilium 也给我们带来一些 K8S 原生的一些 feature， 像网络策略 LB 这些，然后除了这之外，还有像 Hubble 提供的额外的可观测性 ，OK。 总的来说 ，Cilium 是给我们带来一个一致的体验，不管是对用户还是管理员来说。之前的话，我们可能私有云还有各个云厂商，可能要去分别去跑一个不同的网络方案，或者说 CNI。 有了 Cilium 以后，我们是有一个一套方案来让我们在各个云上面多实现这些功能。OK， 可以看一下这张图，这个数据是来自。 中国民航局的一个公布的一个每个月的飞机客运量，这个数据是很大程度上可以反映出来旅游行业的一个情况。那可以看到，2020年疫情爆发以后，是有一波暴跌，是从5000万直接跌到了800万，然后之后的几年由于疫情的反复，是有一个剧烈的波动，在今年终于是迎来了一个反弹，在8月份是有一个破纪录了。 OK， 那这中间呢，对我们的业务是有一个剧烈的波动。那对我们的基础设施也是提出了一些新的要求。首先的话是在业务低迷的时候，我们需要去有效的控制我们的成本。在剧烈波动的时候，我们需要一个自动扩缩容的一个能力。然后在快速增长的阶段，我们需要有大量的可以快速投入生产的一个资源，来支撑我们的业务。那基于这些考虑的话，我们是将 很多的业务负载跑在了阿里云上，随之而来的话是部署了一个比较大的 Cilium 集群。Okay， 那目前这个集群的话，大约是在3000到5000个 Node， 这些 Node 是由 Cluster Autoscaler 来自动扩缩容，然后一共的话是有大概1万到4万个 Pod， 然后我们扩容一台 Node 的时间大概是1分钟左右，这时间就包括去创建一个 Pod， 然后Autoscaler 去触发一个 ASG 的扩容。 然后再到 Node 拉起啊 ，Bootstrap， 再直到 Pod， 到一个 Running 状态。OK， 在这个过程中，我们也遇到过一些挑战。首先一个是我们扩容的性能受制于 Cilium 有一些性能的瓶颈。然后其次的话，我们在集群规模比较大的时候，我们也是在控制面的稳定性是接受了一些挑战。然后同时我们也是。 这种网络模式的比较早的用户，那遇到了很多 bug。目前这些 bug 和性能的优化，我们已经都提交到社区了。OK， 我可以简单看一下在阿里云上面 Cilium 是怎么给一个 pod 分配 IP 的。第一步的话是 Cilium Agent 的启动会创建一个 Cilium Node CID 的资源，这资源会被 operator 去 watch 到，然后 operator 会去调阿里云的 API 来分配创建网卡分配 IP。 之后的话是有一部比较耗时的list ENI， 就是一个同步 ENI 的一个操作，之后的话这些新的 IP 会被同步到 Cilium Node， 然后 Cilium Agent 就可以从这些将这些新的 IP 分配给 Pod， 然后用完 pod 以后，它需要将这个已经使用的信息同步给 API Server 的 Selenium Node。那这个上报的这个动作也有一个15秒的间隔时间，这个间隔时间也是有一些影响我们的扩容性能。OK， 那我们在 operator 做过一些优化。首先的话是，当我们的 ENI 达到1500左右的时候，我们发现我们那个 list 一遍 ENI 花了17秒的时间。经过调查以后发现，其实是里面做了一个不必要的 subnet 的一个便利。我们把这个便利去掉了以后，大概是降到了3秒左右的时间。然后 API 的请求也是下降了很多，对阿里云的压力也是下降了。OK， 那当我们的集群继续扩展的时候，我们ENI 的数量达到过8000个甚至13000个。那在这个阶段呢，我们发现刚才即使是进行过优化，list ENI 还是非常慢。那这个时候已经是没法从阿里云那边再去做优化了，所以我们是重新去思考了一下 Selenium 里的那一部分的代码，发现其中有一部分的list ENI 其实是没有必要去便利所有的 ENI， 而是只需要去获取某一个 node 上的 ENI。OK， 那经过这个优化的话，是把这个耗时固定到了大概2秒钟的时间。Okay， agent 侧的话，我们也做了一些优化，一个是刚才提到的这个15秒的一个写词的一个间隔时间，我们加了一个 flag 去配置。另外的话，其实这一路过来也是遇到过一些 bug， 比如说agent 启动会有一些偶发的问题，一些 race condition 导致我们的 node 启动可能会受到延缓，我们也是做了一些 bug fix。Okay， 另外还有一个值得注意的问题是，目前 Kube Scheduler 在调度 pod 的时候，其实不会考虑这 node 上有没有可用 IP 地址的。也就是说你的 pod 有可能会调到 node 上，然后要等待 CNI 从外部去分配 IP， 甚至说你这台 node IP 的容量已经到顶了，那可能就会一直卡在这个状态。其实 KBS 社区也是有人提过这个问题，但是没有人去修。像 AWS EKS 的话，去解决这种问题是用在 node 启动的时候给 kubelet 去配一个 max pod 这样一个配置，去 walk around， 但其实这对我们来说是比较难管理，因为我们私有云的话可能有不同的 pod CIDR 的大小，而不同的cloud provider 呢可能有不一样的 flavor， 对应不同的 IP 数量。我们的解决方案是用 KBS 的 extended resources 加 device plugin 来实现。这个原理上其实和 NVIDIA 的GPU device plugin 是类似的。首先是通过 device plugin 去读取 Selenium agent 里面IP 数量的一个信息，然后再将它写到API server 的 node status， 将这个做 IP 作为一个资源写进去，然后pod 在创建的时候就可以带着这个资源，这样就实现了一个IP 感知的一个调度。那我们也有一个webhook scheduler 来确保每一个 pod 会带上这样一个资源的申请。OK， 还有一个问题是，我们在集群规模很大的时候，有一个典型的问题是控制面的一个重启分报的一个问题。假设我们的 API server 有一个故障或者性能下降，在短时间内没有恢复，那我们的 Selenium agent 可能会去不断的重连，然后重连到了一定时间以后，它可能会退出重启，而当它重启的时候就会发送一些很多的 listen watch 的请求。我们知道 Listen Watch 请求会去从服务端拉取很大量的数据，同时这些请求又是集中在一起去发送，那导致结果可能就是我们的控制面会不断的被打挂。解决这类问题的话，是需要引入一个指数的 back off， 以及必须要引入一个就是间隔时间要有一个随机性，也就是 jitter。 那目前其实你如果用 daemon set 去跑 Selenium agent 的话，那其实pod 这个 restart policy 它最大的时间间隔只有5分钟，对一个大集群是不够的。另外的话它也不支持 jitter， 如果没有 jitter 的话，那可能就会像左边这张图一样，你虽然每一波的请求的间隔时间越来越长，但其实它没有一个下降的趋势，因为每一波都非常的集中。有 jitter 的话，你可以把这些请求均匀的分散到一段时间里，让你的服务端有更加充足的时间去正常工作。Okay， 那我们的解决方案是在启动 Selenium agent 的时候去写一个脚本来实现这样一个restart back off。一方面然后我们的 agent 也是用 Docker Compose 来起的， 一方面呢是可以对这个重启的一个行为有一个完全的控制，另外一方面呢，我们在升级发布的时候可以有一个更好的灰度控制。最重要的是我们希望Cilium Agent 这样提供底层网络的一个组件可以尽可能的从 KVS 去解耦。举个极端的例子的话，你比如说你用 daemon set 去起一个 Cilium Agent 的 pod， 假如你的创建 pod 有一个 webhook 是通过 service 来暴露的，而这个 service 又依赖于 Cilium Agent 的话，那你可能就会陷入一个循环依赖的问题。然后我们是希望尽可能的去避免这种情况。OK， 那刚才说到这个重启风暴的问题，其实还有一个多集群的版本。那如果你是使用的 Cilium 社区原生的 Cluster Mesh 方案的话，每一个 Cilium Agent 是会去监听每一个集群的 Cilium ETCD。那造成的结果可能是，当你的规模非常大的时候，如果你一个集群的控制面挂了，那就可能会导致这个故障传播到其他集群的 Cilium ETCD， 最终导致整个控制面的一个故障。那我们解决这个问题的方案是引入了一个叫做 KV Store Mesh 的一个设计，这样的话就是使每一个 agent 只连到本地的 Cilium ETCD， 而如果要访问远端的这些元数据的话，是通过一个 operator 来将每个集群的 Cilium ETCD 的数据来做一个同步，这样你只要连接自己集群里的 ETCD 就可以获取到所有集群的 metadata。那这个方案的话，其实社区也有一版实现，在 1.14 是一个 beta 的版本。Okay. 那考虑到一些极端的情况，我们也做了一些应急的处理的准备。其实比如像这种network policy 的一个降级，在比如说假设你的控制面完全挂了，然后Cilium Agent 又起不来了，那这种时候你希望去降级一个 network policy， 让所有的业务能通起来，我们可以去通过操作 eBPF map 来加一条全通的规则，来使至少要让业务的连通性保证。OK， 那我总结一下，我们可能算是踩过的一些坑吧。首先的话是内核的版本，因为你使用 Cilium 肯定是需要去很可能需要去升级内核的嘛。那我们的经验是最好是用一个 patch version 大一点的一个 LTS 的版本，相对来说会稳定一些。然后的话在集群扩张的过程中，需要不停的去关注 Cloud API 的一个 quota， 有可能这方面会被忽视。然后还有关于 ARP table 的一个容量也是需要去关注。为什么专门提一下，是因为Cilium Agent 之间它其实是有一个心跳的 health check。 这个 check 的话，如果在公有云上你用一个非常大的子网，这上面有很多 node 的话，可能会维护一张比较大的邻居表，那这也是值得关注的一个点。OK， 那接下来就是需要去管理你的所有 client 的一个重启的行为。我刚才举的例子是 Cilium Agent， 但其实不仅仅是 Cilium Agent， 在 KBS 里面，你比如像 Kubelet 或者是其他的一些大规模的 agent， 如果它启动的时候要去拉非常大量的一个数据，你都需要去考虑这个问题，因为很可能会陷入这种重启风暴的问题。OK， 那最后的话就是需要对针对 Cilium 有一个故障的一个应急方案吧。OK， 我的分享就是这些，谢谢。大家有什么问题吗？
Hello, I'm from Intel Service Mesh team. I have a question for Cilium. In your roadmap, you mentioned that you will integrate with the ambient Z-tunnel. From my perspective, I think from the functionality perspective, I think the Z-tunnel has some overlap with Cilium. So I'd like to hear what your comments about the integration and the future. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, I think Istio and Cilium Service Mesh both have need to work together. So we're exploring like different ways that they can. So we don't have any specific plans, but we're going to be driven by community interest and what people want and need from both of the projects. So we're looking at like how it can interact with what Cilium does, so that obviously we don't have conflicting things in the network, because that's not great. I know there's been like some things about the conflict between the Istio CNI and the Cilium CNI. So hopefully we can resolve those for people that want to run both Istio and Cilium in the same cluster.
So previously you mentioned that in the roadmap, the CNN will be integrated with the Istio embedded tunnel. So does that mean that you will provide CNI will include both the CNN, current CNN CNI and the tunnel CNI and make it enhance the CNI?
Yeah, so I guess the same question as last time. So we're not making any like predictions about the future of the roadmap. Like in the Cilium project, we're really driven by what end users want and end users need. So we're going to, I guess, have the integration that people demand. So if there's something that you'd like to see, please come comment on GitHub, join the community developer meetings, all of those things.
Hello, I think my question will be in Chinese, sorry. In the trip.com 那个 user case, 你们两个 cluster 主要是解决用 Cilium 到底解决了你们的什么痛点呢？比方说在服务发现跨集群的服务发现，你们怎么解决的？如果说有些问题是level 7层的，你们有用的 Envoy 吗？
我们 Envoy 其实跟 Cilium 是两个团队在做，然后其实我们用 Cilium 解决我们的问题，主要是。 因为我们上一代的网络方案是不能支持这么大的规模，是有一些，不管是 IPAM 的一些性能啊，还是交换机上一些物理表象的一些限制，导致我们没法再用下去了。对，大概是这样。就确实解决了你们在生产环境下用这个是吧？是的，是的。OK，
好，谢谢。有问题问那个曲普一个。
我们知道 Cilium 的话有一个特性，就是说 sidecar free 是吧？你们在你们的集群里面会用到 sidecar 吗？用了 Cilium
之后？我们目前其实还没有，我们目前的话还是用的Istio 的一个这样一个 service mesh， 暂时还没有用到 Cilium 这样子。那么第二个问题就是
Cilium 也会支持安全方面，对吧？我比较关心你们会用到 Cilium 方面的安全方面的一些解决方案吗？比如 Touch On啊，对吧？
Touch On的话，目前还没有在用，但是网络策略是在用的。对。那你们的安全策略的话，这个是用其他的第三方解决方案吗？还是怎么考虑？你指的是哪一部分的安全？比如说一些安全性的，比如入侵分析啊、容器安全这一块东西的。这块目前还没有。我们目前 Cilium 主要用的还是一个 Network Policy 做一个主机防火墙，其他方面的话是。 我们有专门的信安团队去做。还有一个问题是问
Isovalent 的，我知道 Isovalent 是这个，麻烦你 translate 一下，一个是 eBPF 的 low map， eBPF low map， 因为 I know the Isovalent is the eBPF is maintainer，
yeah， that's correct，
eBPF is future， can you share some information to us？
yeah， so I guess people don't know like the creator and co-maintainer of eBPF is Daniel Borkman, and he's at Isovalent. Yeah, that's correct. And I guess a surprise for everybody in this room that isn't public yet, but because you're here, you get to know a little bit early. At KubeCon Chicago in just over a month, we're actually going to be launching the eBPF documentary. So it's going to tell the history of how eBPF was created and where it's going in the future. The actual trailer, official trailer, will be launching on Monday. But because you're here today, you get to find out a little bit early.
Hey,你好，那个我想问一下这个 Cilium 的这位同事啊，就可能需要那个翻译一下。对，就是就去年的时候 Cilium 应该推出一个这个 Cilium Mesh 嘛，然后那个刚才看到的形态上面其实是把 Envoy 包在了里面，作为这么一个对外提供 Mesh 的这么一个能力，对吧？ 然后呢，目前应该四层的能力是通过这种 eBPF 的方式，就通过 eBPF 去原生支持的，七层走到了这个 Envoy 嘛。但是我们也观察到，就是 Cilium 它在那个可观测这一块，其实七层其实也借用了这种 eBPF 的能力。 那就是是不是想请 Selim 同志简单分享一下，比如说后续像这种七层的这种编排啊，就是是不是可以除了观测之外，可以继续通过 eBPF 或者通过其他的方式去那个去继续做这种完整的四到七层的这种编排的这种卸载啊？
Is there any you know eBPF is used for layer 7mesh, and what's the roadmap for the future of layer 4 to layer 7?
Okay, yeah, so maybe I can go back to, it's going to take a second. Yeah, so kind of this slide. So obviously, like, we believe in the power of eBPF. Like, Cilium was built from the ground up based on eBPF. And so we've found that eBPF is very like performant and scalable. So anything that we can do with eBPF and keep it in the kernel, like we will do. There's some things that are a little bit too complex because of the kind of like limitations of eBPF. And that's when we're offloading it to layer 7, which is an Envoy proxy running in user space. But I think kind of if you look at the history of networking, we've really seen a lot of the networking stack move into the kernel, and the experimentation first happens in user space, and then once we kind of figure out like a good way to do it or the best way to do it, that implementation moves into the kernel. So we saw it first with like TCP/IP, and I think we're going to see a similar thing with service mesh. So more and more network functionality will move into the kernel, and we're going to see that with Cilium service mesh, and I think that's kind of the roadmap. If you want to talk about like more specific things, I would once again like join the developer meeting. There's also an APAC friendly developer meeting, and like jump into some of the issues on GitHub if you think there's something missing or that you'd like to see.
Thanks a lot for the great presentation. I have a question for actually both Jeff and Bill. So we have been using a different solution than Cilium, which I'm not going to name in front of camera, but something we run into is we found when the node or pod are not gracefully shut down, the IP allocation would get leaked. So I'm wondering, like, I guess for Jeff, have you folks run into similar situations with Cilium, and is there anything you did, like, did you folks do anything for that? And for Bill, is there any kind of requirement on like how the node or the pod should be shut down? And have you folks, I guess, in the community heard any kind of situations like IP allocations get leaked and it's just like, you know, all taken away, so it's kind of assign new IP to the nodes and then, you know, the whole thing just cannot work. Thanks.
Yeah, we kind of run into an IP leak, and I guess there are many solutions for that. What we have recently found is that when you create a ENI on a public cloud, you could run into issues that from performance or you know provider changes, and your ENI could run into a rollback logic, and if you your rollback fails, that ENI could just leak. So I guess right now Cilium have a back-off mechanism in IP allocation for public clouds. So it will kind of slow down the procedure, but you have to do some monitoring to find out the issue, I would guess.
Yeah, I guess kind of the second half of that is, I guess we're like aware of some of that, also like the reuse of IPs and stuff, and that's something that we're working on for the future. So I would say look for updates in the 1.15 release cycle, which should probably be coming out early next year.
So, 还有一个问题就是这个刚才提到 Hubble， 你们有没有对 Hubble 做过一些优化，包括那个包括一些那个 Hubble 的那个 metrics 那个 persistence， 因为如果没有 persistence， 它好像时间很短，只有一天不到可以看这个 metrics。
我们现在其实是 Hubble 是存到内部的 ELK 的集群里去的。
就作为一个 audit 的日志输出出来这样子。对，然后有一个persistent 的一个存储，对，应该是这样子。
我问一个问题，就是原生的 Selenium 的话，如果比如它是用这个 Selenium Class Mesh 然后做多集群的一个互联嘛，那这样网络策略的话，它有这比如 Selenium Network Policy， 那它是不是可能原生它是不是需要多个集群，我要下发这个相同的这个策略嘛？那我可能一样的配置，我需要发两份是吗？
是的，所以我刚才
所以你们是有那刚才提到
我们是有一个 Kubernetes 来做创建这个 Network Policy 的，就有一个 Federated 的一个自己定义的一个网络策略，然后
那你们会有一个单独一个中心的集群，把这个资源 apply 到下面，然后它下发到下去。
是的，是的，是这样
的。好的，谢
谢。Any more questions?
Oh. 哎，我想问一下那个携程的同学。就刚才说有那个原生的 Selenium 碰到一些问题嘛，然后你们做了一些优化，我想问一下这个这个优化的版本跟社区的版本然后是怎么的对应关系，比如说社区的版本后续升级了，那你们自己的版本是要一直跟它对齐，还是说某些情况下才会去升级？
是某些情况下才会去升级的。其实我们大部分可以 upstream 的一些改动其实都已经提到社区了，内部尽可能去维护少一些的 commit， 不然每一次升级可能那个。
好的，明白，谢谢。
Okay, time's up. If you have any more questions, the Selenium booth, come by the Selenium booth tomorrow morning from 10:30 to 2:30, and I'll be happy to answer any questions that you have. And thanks for coming today.